Good morning, CWC. How are we all doing this morning?
Good.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time?
God is good.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time?
God is good.
Welcome, everybody. Go ahead and stand up on your feet. Say hello to a few people around you. I just want to welcome you guys in to the house of the Lord, where God is good all of the time. He is great all of the time, and His glory is going to pour out all of the time. Go ahead and stand up. I'm going to pray real quick. In the name of Jesus, Holy Spirit, we invite your presence. Holy Spirit, we invite your glory. Lord, fall and pour out your anointing on your people this morning. We give you all the glory and all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Everywhere kindness and mercy will follow me, surrounding me where I go.
You promise me.
You promise me. That you'll never leave. You promise me. I'm never forsaken. I believe
that your goodness,
your goodness and mercy will follow me, surrounding me where I go.
Worship this morning.
Come on.
Us have experienced the goodness of God. His mercies are new every single morning. We thank you, Jesus.
You've been so good. You've been so good. I thank you, Lord. I thank you. My heart is full. My heart is full. I love you, Lord. I love you.
You've been so good. So good, I thank you, Lord, I thank you. My heart is full, my heart is full. I love you, Lord, I love you. You've been so good, you've been so good. I thank you, Lord, I thank you. My heart is full.
You've been so good,
you've been so
lips this morning. God's been so good. He gave us the breath of life this morning. We can praise Him this morning.
What you've done for me, you are faithful. You never failed me yet, never failed me yet. You've been good to me, I'm grateful.
How can I forget what you've done for me, you are faithful.
You never failed me yet, never failed me yet. You are good to me, and I'm grateful.
How can I forget
what you've done for me, you are faithful.
Never fail me yet, never fail me yet. You are good to me, and I'm grateful.
How can I forget, say?
How can I forget what you've done for me, you are faithful.
You never fail me yet.
Never fail me yet, never fail me yet. You are good to me, and I'm grateful.
Listen.
You to just give him a shout of praise if he's been faithful in your life, if he has met your needs, if he has set you free. Come on, don't we serve a good God? Don't we serve a faithful God, a loyal God, a God who loves you to the ends of this earth, a God that would die for you? He loves you. We serve him, and he is worthy of all our praise. He is worthy of all our worship. Man, there's no place I'd rather be than be in his presence. There is no place I'd rather be than be in his presence. And if we could just lift our hands and lean in this morning to what God wants. Lean into what he wants for you. Just lean in this morning. Oh, you've been so good. So good. Jesus, the Son of God.
Oh. Father, in this moment. We just come into your presence, Jesus, lifting you up and praising your name, my God. Just come into this place with your people as we come in to worship you, God, to hear a message to receive from you today, my Jesus. Lord, I thank you for your presence and your continued presence upon this place and everywhere that we go, Father God. I pray, Lord, that we set our hearts ready for what is to receive in this moment. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Can you give the worship team a round of applause today, church? They did such an amazing job. Man, I almost didn't see them in their camouflage there. Oh, man. Woo. Oh, nobody gave me the idea to wear my camouflage outfit. Oh, man. It's good to see everybody's faces here today. Look to your left and look to your right. Say, good morning. Good morning. Make sure you rub your eyes. Nobody falling asleep today. It is a great service today. I'm excited for what we have set up for you guys. But before we do so, I want to just say if there's any first-time visitors, if we can actually have our ushers come on forward, the offering. If you're a first-time visitor, I'd love for you to raise your hand around you so we can recognize you and let you know. Well, good morning today. How you doing, sir? Good morning. I think we have some visitors over here also. Welcome. We want to say welcome. Church, if you see somebody next to you in the aisle, please greet them and say hello and get to know them after, before and after service. But also, if you could also scan our QR code here. We'd love to get your information so that we can get connected with you and show about all the amazing things that are happening here at CWC Life. We have so much going on. You'll see in our announcements in this minute. But we just want to get connected with you. Now we have the opportunity and awesome privilege to give to God, right? It's an amazing time because God has given so much to us. We want to be able to give back to him what he's been so faithful to us for. And so today, if you guys would like, there's also the QR code on the back. Or if you would like to text the phone number back here, which is 844-970-2859. That is our Tithely phone number that you could be able to text your card into and stuff like that. And so we'd love for you guys to help out. Okay? So let's pray in for our offering. Dear Father, I pray for those that are giving today, Father God. I pray that you bless their homes, bless their finances, bless their jobs, Father God. I pray that with their faithfulness, Lord, they're giving with a cheerful heart today, Lord. But also for those that are unable to give, Father God, I pray that you also open opportunities and doors and resources into their life, Father God, so they can see the faithfulness of you, my Lord, within them, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Come on, church. I love tithe and offering time. Whoop.
Mic 7.
Testing. There we go. All righty. So let's go into birthdays real quick. I want to say happy birthday to Alice Garcia and Israel Velasquez. All right. Just two birthdays today, all right? Quick and easy. But happy birthday. May God bless you this year and continue to bless you. For announcements this week, we have quite a few. So if you guys could just bear with me, all right? This Wednesday, April 10th, is our potluck and friends. Everybody say potluck and friends. Come on, we get to hang out with our friends. Invite those that have never been here to this potluck. It's the time to draw people in, but also have a great time of fellowship and food. Who does not like food, right? Invite someone out this Wednesday for potluck and friends. Now, everybody say baptisms. Baptisms. If you want to get baptized, please go into the back to our information desk in the foyer if you would like to sign up for our baptisms or also scan the QR code. Man, who's that good-looking guy right there? If you would like to get baptized, we would love for you to do so. Next Sunday, we have baptisms. But this coming Wednesday, we want to be able to take you through a class and be able to teach about what are baptisms, why do we do baptisms, what is the representation, and why does God encourage us and ask us to get baptized. It's a biblical thing, and it's just to show everybody else around you that you're going down one person coming up new. We're all a new creation in Christ Jesus, and we could be able to do this in front of our friends, family, and loved ones. So if you could also scan that QR code and then come to the class this Wednesday at 6 p.m. before potluck and friends. We'll kind of just go through the whole thing, how we do it, what to wear, all that different kind of stuff. And I'll be teaching that class, and I'd love to take you through that. But baptisms are next Sunday, so if you want to invite those out, to encourage them to be a part of what you guys have chosen to do today, or next Sunday. Also, we are doing baby dedications April 28th. If you're looking to sign up, we'd love for one to be, okay, I'm just going to read this. We just love for you to sign up, okay, guys? We have the QR code right here. This is the best time where we get to be able to just dedicate our babies. We baptize those that are older, right? Because we know that we are of sin, but babies are perfect and a gift from God. And we want to be able to just say that, Lord, we dedicate them, and we say from this point forward, we'll train up a child in the way they should go, and when they're old, they'll never depart from it. Right? Because it's going to be deep down in their heart. And so it's mainly for the parents to say that I choose to put God first in our home and in our child's life. And so if you want to have a baby dedication, if you want to get your baby dedicated, we would love to do so April 28th. So if you scan the QR code or once again go to our information booth in the back, we'd love to get you guys started there. Our CWC Life bike blessing will be April 27th. Come on, guys. But it's also not just a bike blessing, but it's our church festival, our car show. It's an amazing time where we get to come out and have all these beautiful cars and all these people. We get to pray over those that are with the cars and bikes. Because they're, how many know it's dangerous on a bike, right? Come on. And it's dangerous on the road. And we get to have a time where we get to pray over them and bless them and just make sure that they're safe on the road. But we just also, there's more food, more vendors. Bounce houses for the kids. We get to have all this time, and we'd love for you guys to be a part. If you have a classic car, a motorcycle, or even a classic bike, a little tricycle or something, we'd love for you guys to come on out, be a part. We have a car show. There will be judges and trophies and singers and musicians and rap artists and all kinds of different things out there. We'd love for you guys to come out and enjoy that time. So that is April 27th is our CWC Life Festival. Can I hear my ladies in the church today? You guys are filling up our calendar. Come on. You guys just had your conference, and now you want to do your women's tea? Come on. Women's tea will be on May 18th. Tickets are now available in the back. Women will have a table in the back for $35. If you're interested in hosting a table, please see Judy or call the church office. Our women's tea fills up this whole sanctuary. There's all kinds of theme tables and things like that. And just all the ladies have a great time. They have raffles, and it's just awesome. They have food. There's food again. Come on. There's something about a theme here. We have food. And so it's just a great time for ladies. Come on out. It's a great time to just get to know other people and join out and have great fellowship and fun. So women's tea in the back. Can I hear all my men, though? I think the ladies were a little bit louder. Can I hear my men, though? All righty. We have food also. Men's conference, Saturday, June 29th. Register in the back at the end of service. We have some amazing speakers. We are going to be able to hear from our Z. We're going to be able to hear from me. We're going to be able to hear from our very own bishop and Pastor Menchaca from all the way from Dinuba. Amazing speakers. We're going to come in and just share about one more round. Everybody say one more round. Come on, if we just go one more round, sometimes we don't feel like we can just move forward, but God says just one more round. Men, we just need to fight for our families. We need to fight for our churches. We need to fight for our communities. We need to fight for our own lives and our own souls. So we are going to encourage you guys to go one more round and have some food, all right? Be able to go in the back after service, and you'll be able to sign up there as well. And so amazing things. If you also want to check out these things, they are also on our church website, CWCManteca.org. All of our events are on there. And eventually we'll be having our church app where you guys will be able to see all those also. Okay, guys? And so I'm going to love to encourage to bring up our very own Bishop Steve Perea. He is an amazing man. This will be one of the first times on the stage after his hip surgery. Doesn't he walk in real good? Man. I don't know about you, but if I had hip surgery, I do not know if I'd be able to walk like this man right here.
Good morning, everyone. How's everybody doing? It's so good to be here. So good to see you. Missed you all so much. I loved being here last week. Easter Sunday, I was just praying and praying that God would allow me to be here for Easter Sunday, and I got to be here. But I get to be with you here today and see you here. I'm doing very well. God has been with me and blessed me. I can't wait to preach. I'll be preaching next week, and I'm excited about that. But last Sunday was so amazing. Man, everybody worked so hard. All of our cast and crew and media and sound and ushers, security, nursery, on and on and on. What an amazing, amazing day that was. And I always say that Easter Sunday helps us to see our potential. Who the church was so full. We had a great attendance at 8:45, great attendance at 12:30, and definitely wall-to-wall during the 10 o'clock or 10:30 service. And it helps us to see, well, this is our key, this is our potential, what we can definitely grow to. And I know we are going to do that. So I'm excited about that. But today was another day I just did not want to miss, because today we recognize those who have gone through blueprints with us. So if in all the groups, if you've gone through blueprints with us, stand to your feet. Even if you didn't finish, just stand to your feet. Yes, come on. All right, come make your way up here. Come all the way up front. Come on, give them a big round of applause. Yes. Good job, everybody. Women's group, couples group, men's group, youth group, young adults, children, everybody. Keep coming. Keep coming. Make your way all the way up. Come on up closer. This is so incredible. This is so amazing. You see, we've all heard of Jesus, but now you know Jesus. And now you can teach Jesus. There's nothing more pure in the gospel, what we do, than creating disciples. And now you've been taught, you've been discipled in the things of God, and Blueprints has taught you the word, who Jesus is, worship, and on and on. And today, I want to graduate you from Blueprints and say you are officially a disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. You are officially a disciple of Jesus Christ. And what does that mean? You're a follower. You are a follower of Christ. So I pray that you take that with your whole heart. You are a follower of Jesus Christ. What an amazing, amazing commitment you have made. And I thank God for you. I thank God. It's so powerful that you've done this. Now, let me read to you one portion of scripture. It's found in the book of Matthew, chapter 28. And Jesus said, and he spoke to them and said, all authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. He said, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. By the way, all of you disciples, if you have not been baptized, next week, get ready. Make sure you sign up. So baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and then the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And he said, and lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the world. So here's what I want to do. I want to congratulate you for graduating Blueprints and becoming a disciple of Jesus Christ. Now, I say to you, go and disciple one. Go and disciple one. Take that blueprint book. We'll have them ready for every single one of you. Call a neighbor, an uncle, an aunt, a friend, a workmate at work, and say, hey, would you meet with me one day a week, and I'll take you through this quick study of who God is. I want to challenge all of my disciples here today to pick one. And I'm hoping that in 8 or 9 weeks, we can have another graduation of disciples here. Wouldn't that be amazing if every single one of you brought somebody up that day and we graduate them? So I'm asking you all to do this, to go find one and get them to commit to discipleship with you, to go through Blueprints one day a week. But then I want you to report to your group leader and let your group leader know, okay, I'm taking somebody through. I'm taking somebody through. This is the purest form and the most basic form of discipleship. And I guarantee you, we can change the world if every single one of us took one, just one. From now, the next 3 months, if we all took one person through Blueprints, led them to Jesus, get them founded in the Word, and then we bring them up here and graduate. And guess what? What if that class disciples one, and then you go disciple another before the end of the year? We can change the world. This was the plan. This is the plan of Jesus Christ. This is what he meant when he said, go therefore, disciple one. All of you now, I want you to raise your hands. Raise your hands to God. Heavenly Father, I present to you the first graduating class of our Blueprints Discipleship course. And I hereby, God, commission them to go. I commission them to go and to find one. To find one and to take them through Blueprints, God. So I hereby commission them in the name of Jesus, the name that is above every name. The name that is above every name, I commission them now, God, to go, therefore, and to disciple one. Father God, put that person in our hearts right now. Help us to see that person right now, God. In Jesus' name, show us that person, God, and help us, Father God, to be committed to discipling them. And I pray this blessing upon all of these disciples. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Wow. Here's the plan, folks. You're now discipled. Go find one and disciple them. Let's bring them up to graduation in a few months. And let's challenge them. And then I'll challenge you. Go get your second. I just got a feeling that God's going to cause revival in such a way that we have never seen before. In such a way that maybe Northern California has never seen before. Let's make disciples of everyone. Come on, church. How many see that? How many are with me? Let's get it done. Let's go. Let's do it. Are you ready? I'm so proud of you. I'm so proud of you. And I pray that you follow Jesus the rest of your life forever. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. Man, Cal said that 65 children went through Blueprints. Is that incredible? 65 kids. That's amazing. Praise God. That's amazing. God bless you. And I look forward to you talking to your group leader about who you're taking through groups. Don't forget, this week, we have our potluck and friends. I'm asking everyone here that's in the house, not just those that came up, but everybody, bring a guest. Bring a visitor. That's what Potluck and Friends is all about. Bring a visitor this Wednesday. Amen. Praise God. That was awesome. What a beautiful sight. Did we take a picture, anybody? Oh, they did good. All right. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Amen. Well, listen, we, as I was saying, this Wednesday, bring a guest, a visitor, an uncle. Bring the person you want to disciple. Bring them this Wednesday. And say, hey, we're having a potluck. People love food. They love potlucks. It's a party. Tell them, hey, let's go. We're going to my church. It's a party potluck. And they'll come. Just invite them. You do the inviting and passionately bring them and find that one person to disciple. Praise God. Well, listen, the Lord put a word on my heart called unqualified. Have you ever been told that you're unqualified? It's not a good feeling. It's not a good feeling. The enemy wants you to believe that you're unqualified for heaven, that you're unqualified to be saved. The enemy wants you to believe that. But listen, when you're told you're unqualified, you can either accept it and go away, or you can press on and show them differently. Help me welcome Pastor Chris as he shares the word of God today.
Go for it. Come on, Bishop. Come on. How many of you grateful for our senior pastor? I'm so grateful for our senior pastor. I'm so grateful that he's here. I'm grateful for the calling that's on his life. And I'm grateful that he's healing and recovering. And come on, he was ready to preach right now. I know he was. He was ready to preach it right now. So so glad to have you back in the house, Bishop. And looking forward to what God's going to do here in this new season. It's going to be amazing. And grateful that you get to be a part of that too. Amen. And well, I'm excited because this word has been stirring up in me, And I'm praying that the Holy Spirit touches you here this morning, because I know that there's divine appointments. So let's pray, and we're going to get right into this. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your truth. We thank you because we know, God, that we are defined by who you say that we are, Lord Jesus. And so, Holy Spirit, I pray that you would move in this place and that you would touch our hearts and transform and renew us as only you can. In Jesus' name I pray, amen, amen. Well, here's the truth, church. Here's the reality of what's presented before us. The reality is when you look at the Word of God and you read through this, Scripture is full of people who are unqualified. When you look at this book, it is full of people like you and I who had so much sin in their lives that needed redemption, that needed divine intervention. So when you look at this, you need to understand that you're not alone in your struggle, and you're not alone in that internal fight of feeling like you're not good enough. We read time and time again, especially in the Old Testament, and we're going to be going over in these next couple of weeks, of people who were unqualified. And sometimes we read these stories, right, and we're like, that's cute. That's a cool story. God turned that around from them, brother and sister. God turned it around. You know, they didn't fit the description, but, you know, God did it for them. But you don't believe that for yourself. And I'm here to tell you this morning, we need to shake off that poverty mindset and that poor me spirit that says, I'm not good enough. Last week, the sanctuary was packed as people got to see the greatest message ever. And that's that there is a man who died on your behalf to purchase you. And we celebrate that, and it's a powerful thing. And Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, the grave is empty. He qualified you by his precious blood. And we celebrate it on Sunday. And then Monday comes, and we're like, yeah, that was cool. But, like, I don't know. I feel like I still can't do this. I'm here to tell you, there's a God who says that you can. And in particular, this morning, I want to talk about King David. Come on, y'all love King David. I know I do. I see so much, I can relate to so much that King David went through. And in particular, there's two points in David's life that I want to highlight to you this morning that I feel like if we're all honest, here's the key, you have to be honest. If we're all honest, we can relate to some point in the timeline of David's life. And the first part of David's life that I want to speak to you this morning about, and it's the one that often gets talked about when we're talking about being unqualified, and it's the fact that he was overlooked by his father. We read it in 1 Samuel. We read it in 1 Samuel. And I believe we have that up here for you guys to reference too. We read in 1 Samuel. Right? We know King David as the giant killer and all this crazy awesome stuff, right? But we forget that at one point he was just this little guy that was forgotten. And I don't know, I can relate to him because I'm 5'4 when I'm not slouched, okay? So I can relate, okay? I'm a little guy. That's okay. I got a big heart. So David was just a little guy, right? And check this out. And we know the story, and I want to just talk about this for just a moment. King Saul, at this point, King Saul was out. God's like, yeah, he rejected Saul as king, so they needed a new king. So he tells Samuel, go to Bethlehem and get Jesse's sons, and we're going to anoint one of them as king. Check this out. Jesse, the father of David, you know, he has brothers. The father of David gets all his sons together, but one. That one being David. And out picture Jesse as a father. He's thinking, oh, man, I got to bring my best, right? I got to bring my tallest, my strongest, you know, my best looking, the best leader. I got to bring them because I want to show, you know, what I feel qualifies to be worthy of a king. So in his mind, Jesse, the father, had his own qualifications of what needed to be presented. And at some point in that exchange, he thought, yeah, I don't think David meets those qualifications. See, David had a father who told him he didn't qualify. But David had a heavenly father that told him he was qualified. And so even in that place of vulnerability where David was forgotten, right? And I don't know about you guys, but if I get forgotten and overlooked, I'm like, yeah, I'm not going to show my face. But David understood that it was not what others said about him that qualified him. It is what the King of Kings thought about him that qualified him. And there's a lot of you in here this morning, if you're honest, think about that. It was his own father that told him that he didn't meet the requirements, the prerequisites to be presented before the prophet. It was his own father. And there's a lot of you here in this place who those who have been closest to you have told you that you are not qualified to do what is before you. And it hurts the most when it's somebody who is closest to you. And I would imagine that David must have had this moment in his life and the struggle where he's like, man, my own dad didn't even invite me to the ceremony. My own dad thought that I did not meet even the most minimum of requirements because if I would have, he would have brought me. But he just said, when I look at the boxes, there's not one that you check off, David. So just do what you got to do out there. And so many times in our lives, we have these checkmark boxes that we're trying to fill and not fill that would we feel make us worthy to do what God has called us to do. But God doesn't look at a checkbox when he sees your life. He sees your heart. And this is where we read one of the most powerful portions of Scripture, right? Where Samuel's looking at David's brothers and he's like, yeah, this guy's tall. This guy can do it. And what does God say? Man looks at outward appearance. Right? In other words, Samuel, you had your own qualifications for what you thought I was looking for in a king. But then God says, but I look at the heart. I look at the inward. In other words, God's telling you this morning that you have your own standard that you think you need to qualify for, but God is the one who ultimately has the final say. So even Samuel, the prophet of God, the man that God sent to anoint the king, didn't understand the full qualification. And so we see the story where David is really, he's from the get-go told that he's not enough to be the king. And we know the story. God anoints him, and he's still chosen. And he does meet the qualifications, and there's that exchange where you see the character of God at work even at that point in David's life. And there's those of you today that are walking with that burden of feeling like I often get overlooked. I'm very much not sure of where I stand and fit in the kingdom of God. I'm not really confident in who I am as a person. I don't really, you know, fit the bill. I don't really fit the description. I don't really have the qualities that I know need to be had in order to be used by God. But when God chooses you, all other qualifications become irrelevant. They're irrelevant. And maybe you're in a place where you have made your own list of attributes that describe someone who can be used by God, and you're looking at yourself and you're saying, it doesn't fit me. Maybe you're here and you come to church on Sundays and on Wednesdays, you hear a good word and you leave because you don't even see the point in trying. You're like, I don't meet the requirement, so I'm just going to do the bare minimum. I'm here to tell you this morning that it's not your attributes that qualify you, it's his attributes that qualify you. Come on, it's not what you can do in your own capacity, because let's be real. If God based his plan and purpose on if we were qualified or not, nothing would get done. Nothing would get done. If he based it on what we can do on our own, nothing would be accomplished. But how many know he sent a mediator on our behalf to take our place? Come on, you have to understand that. So that's the first little portion of you know, David being unqualified. And I feel like that's the main one that normally gets talked about. But there's a second part. And this one is really one that I want to hit. Because I know that it's one that I've struggled with in the past. I know that you can all relate to this. And really, we know that obviously David was qualified. And we see all the incredible things that he's done. Right? What is David known as? David was known as a man after God's own heart. But do you know that this man who obviously God handpicked, we just read that in 1 Samuel 16, that God picked him, anointed him, set him apart. Why? Because God knew that he was qualified to do the work of the Father. So he gets qualified, and we know the life of David. He did incredible things. He slayed Goliath. He conquered, you know, kingdoms. He established the people of God. He was an incredible leader, an incredible worshiper, an incredible man of God. But there's this little novella that happens in his life. How many of y'all grew up watching novellas? And listen, I'm not talking about the English soap operas because those don't hit. They don't hit the same. I'm talking about the novellas where you're just like, I don't even understand what they're saying, but I can feel what they're saying. You know what I mean? Like, you can put a novella on and you don't know what's happening, but you know what's happening. And so this little novella happens in David's life, and we can find it's up here on the screen, but I'm going to give you the synopsis here, okay? Because it helps me too. Sometimes you can read the story and be like, oh, that's cool. But no, check this out. This novella was real. This is a man of God. He's established. He's incredible. He's a man after God's own heart. Check this out. One day, he was supposed to be out in battle, but he's home chilling, okay? That's a whole other sermon that can be preached, right? But we're not going to go there right now. But check this out. He's home, even though he wasn't supposed to be in. He's out chilling on his roof, and he's looking out at all his kingdom, and he sees a lady bathing, Bathsheba. Okay, he sees her bathing, and he gets intrigued. He gets intrigued, and he asks, "Who is this lady?" And they tell him, "Oh, that's the wife of Uriah." So this dude not only is looking at her, and then he realizes she has a husband, and he's like, "Okay, that doesn't matter. Invite her over." He invites her over to Netflix and chill. I'm just kidding. They didn't have Netflix back then. They didn't have that. But listen, he invites her over not to have a Bible study. He didn't invite her over to do a devotion. Right? So, fellas, I'm telling you right now, stop inviting her over. You know you're not doing devotional, so stop. So David invites her over, clearly with not the right intentions. They end up sleeping together. She goes home, and then she tells him, "I'm pregnant, David." So David says, wow, talk about novella, right? This is Bible. This is the man after God's own heart. This is happening, okay? This is the same one that God qualified already. We just talked about that, right? So he finds out she's pregnant, and he says, well, I got to fix this. How am I going to fix this? I have an idea. I'm going to call her husband. Her husband was literally one of his soldiers fighting on his behalf for the kingdom. He says, call for her husband to come home. And when he comes home, he's going to be so happy to be home, being away from his wife. He's going to sleep with his wife. And then I can pretend that it's not my kid. I'm just going to say, oh, well, it's her. He came home. It's got to be his. It's not mine. So his solution was that I'm going to pretend like it's not my child. I'm going to make it all work here. Well, Uriah had so much honor in his life that he came home, and scripture says that instead of going home to his wife, he slept outside of the palace. Because he said, my men are out fighting. How could I dare want to be with my wife? My men are out there sleeping in tents in the ground. I'm going to do the same thing. So David's like, you didn't go home? You didn't go home? And I would imagine, get perspective here. This is a man who had a relationship with God, who knew him, and this turmoil is going on in his head. And he says, you didn't go home? All right, that's okay. Just stay another day. So then David says, I'm going to keep him here. I'm just going to get him drunk. I'm going to get him to feel relaxed. So he keeps him there. He feeds him. He gets him drunk. He says, surely tonight he's going to go home and sleep with his wife. Well, scripture says he went outside and slept with the palace again. He didn't go home to his wife. So at this point, all of David's resolutions aren't working. It's not working. This novella gets worse. So he says, all right, I'm trying my best here. So my last idea is this. How about you send him back to the front lines to where the fighting is the fiercest? Put him right at the heart of the battle. And when you get him there, leave him. Think about that. David's idea to fix it was to put him in the front line. And he told his generals, he said, take him. And then ditch him and leave him there to die. And scripture says that that's exactly what happened. He died. Why am I telling you this? I'm telling you this because this was a man who was qualified by God to do a great work. And if I just told you that novella that happened, if you think about that, does that sound like somebody who should have been qualified to lead the people of God? It doesn't. He sinned, he fell, he made a mistake. But here's the powerful thing about David. David had a repentant heart. And if you read Psalms and you read some of the songs that he wrote in that pain and that anguish of what he felt, you would see that even in his lowest point, he understood where his qualification came from. He understood that he wasn't the sum of his mistakes. And we read in Scripture that even in that mess that he made, he repented before the Lord. He came before him and he didn't allow even his own doing. Right? Because it's one thing for somebody to tell us that we're not qualified. But so many times it's us internally. We feel guilty from the mistakes that we've made. We feel guilty and shame from the things that we've gotten wrong. We feel like we don't deserve for a second, third, fourth chance, whatever that is. But we see the heart of David, and you read it when he tells God, "Cleanse me, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me." Why did he do that? He knew that because he understood who was the one that qualified him. He understood that he tried to fix it, but there was only one who could really fix it. And we read this and we read obviously how crazy the story is, and we're like, man, I would never do that. Man, that's crazy. But the reality is every single one of us in here has made mistakes. The reality is that if we look at our own lives, we can say there's been sin in my life where I failed. There's been times in my life where I feel like I haven't been worthy. There's been times in my life where I've walked with that guilt and that shame. I don't know about you, but if I just went through what David did, I would have been like, Lord, take me because I don't deserve to even be here. I don't deserve to push through what just happened here. But we know that this wasn't the end of David's life right here. This wasn't the end of his life. Did it cause mess and chaos? Absolutely. And David had to deal with those repercussions. But it never prevented him from continuing to pursue the Heavenly Father and never stopped him from knowing that he was qualified to do what God had called him. David knew. And so we read that and we see that, I wouldn't, thank goodness I'm not the Lord, because I do a lot of things wrong. But I'd look at David and be like, yeah, dude, I think you just disqualified yourself, man. So why don't we step out? But that's not what happened here. David understood. David understood who was the one who qualified him. Right? What we read in 1 John 1:9, what does 1 John 1:9 says? It says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us. And check this out. It says, not only is he faithful and just to forgive us, it says, but then he cleanses us from all unrighteousness. That's what David understood. His own mistakes didn't even disqualify him. His own wrongdoing didn't take away what God had in store for his life. And you might be here today, and I really felt this. You might be here today, and you're walking with guilt and shame. You're walking with that confliction of, man, I did this to myself. This is my fault. I'm the one that messed this up. Listen, maybe you did, but I know one who didn't mess it up. His name is Jesus, and he intentionally chose you. He intentionally set you apart, right? Scripture says that we're his handiwork. He knows the depths of your heart. Right, we read even in Proverbs and in Psalms, right, that God knows, Scripture says that he knows the words before they're even on my tongue. He knows, and he still chooses you. He still chooses you. He still chose David even in the midst of all of that chaos. And what do we know David as? A man after God's own heart. In other words, we know him more for what he did right than for what he did wrong. Why? Because we can look to the one who qualified him. We can look to the one who writes the story. We know the author and the finisher of our faith. And I want to talk specifically, because if I'm transparent with you guys, there's been a lot of times in my life where I've felt like I don't qualify. And maybe it's because I was always the smallest. Maybe it's because, I don't know, this could be a lot of reasons. But I have struggled with that a lot of times. Because here's the truth. There's always somebody who's more educated than you. There's always somebody who is better at you than something. There's always somebody who could probably, you know, do what you can do, but 10 times better. There always is. But God created you
with what you have to do what he wants. And here's what we have to understand. We were all purchased with the same blood. We were all purchased with the same blood of Jesus. In other words, just because somebody, you know, we look at our pastors, right? We look at our pastors like, well, maybe they got saved by like a special blood that Jesus had. Like a special little compartment that he has and he sprinkled on them. And that's why they're a little bit better. No, the same grace that I have is the same grace that you have. Jesus didn't die on the cross and say, I'm only going to qualify you, and so I'm going to give you this special little dose of this. No, he said, I'm going to pour out my life. I'm going to be crushed in spirit. I'm going to pour out my blood. I'm going to redeem you just like I'm redeeming the one who's sitting next to you. And so we cannot compare ourselves. Come on, you cannot disqualify yourself because you feel like you aren't enough. Jesus said you are enough. Where do we see that? I want to read this to you guys. This is incredibly powerful. I love this portion of scripture in Romans 5. If you have your Bibles, go to Romans 5. Romans 5, verse 1 through 10. I got to read this to you because you guys have to understand. David, we see the life of David. I don't know about you, but I can relate to so many parts of his life. David understood where his qualification came from. David understood that even in his darkest moments, read Psalms, even in his darkest moments, he knew where to look. And so I'm here to help you this morning. I'm going to show you where you can look. Read this with me. So if you want to know where to look, this is where you look. It says this in 5:1. It says, Romans 5:1. Therefore, having been justified by faith, come on, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. You've been justified. You've been qualified. Come on. You've been picked. We now have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access. Come on. So not only are you qualified, but now you've been given access. That's a whole nother level right there. Because he could have said, I'm just going to save you, but stay over there in your far corner. Just stay over there and don't mess it up too bad, okay? I saved you, so just sit over there. Don't come close. No, what does he say? I justified you, and I now give you access. I pull you in. So not only am I going to suffer and die for you and take your place so that you can be justified, so that you can be qualified, but after that, I'm going to give you access, and I'm going to pull you in. So it says, with whom also we have access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only that, but we also glory in tribulations. Come on, that's what David did. He understood that even his own mistakes were simply opportunities for the character of God to be revealed in his life. So he says, and not only that, but we also glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, and perseverance character, and character hope. Now, hope does not disappoint because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. And then I love this. Come on. And I love this right here. You got to tune into this right here. Because at the end of the day, I can tell you you're qualified, but it's not until you read this and believe it that you truly see that you are qualified. This is what qualifies you right here. This is it right here. Understand this. Understand this. I'm going to preach this. Can I preach this? Come on. It says this. For when we were still without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die. Yet perhaps for a good man, someone would even dare to die. Come on, it says, but God demonstrates his own love toward us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, much more, having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. You've been qualified by his life. And not only that, but we also rejoice. Come on. It's possible to rejoice even in the face of your failures. It's possible to rejoice even in your shortcomings. Why can we rejoice? Because we know what the scripture says, that it was Jesus Christ through whom we have now have reconciliation. Church, you got to understand that when Jesus made the decision to die for you, he wasn't thinking of you seeing an awesome God on 786 Button Avenue in Manteca, California. When Jesus made the decision to leave the comfort of heaven, come on, this is the gospel, this is the good news. When Jesus made the decision to qualify you, he wasn't picturing you on a Sunday morning on Button Avenue singing awesome God. He did it picturing you doing the worst thing that you have ever done. He did it with the worst version of yourself. He saw the worst of it, right? What does scripture say? We were his enemies, and he made the decision to qualify you. So if he made the decision to qualify you when you were at your worst, how much more are you qualified now as you stand here redeemed by the precious blood of Jesus? It's not your ability. It's not how good you are at something. It's not about, you know, all the things that you got right. There's only one thing that you need to get right, and that's turning to him. Turning to the author. Turning to the one who reconciled everything in your life to him and made you in right standing before God. What does scripture say? In Hebrews it says that we can boldly approach the throne now, full of confidence. Full of confidence, we can boldly approach God. We're qualified to approach God. You are. But so many of us fight this feeling of a feeling that we're not good enough. And like I've told you, I've had this personal struggle, much like David, overlooked. I've struggled with that, feeling like, man, there's no way. And I read the life of David, and I see what he went through, and I see how even in his ups and his downs, God still qualified him because David still pursued him even in his shortcomings. But I struggle with that, and I want to be transparent with you. I want to give you an example, and this sounds a little bit silly, but I hope that it gives you perspective. I remember being a kid. I loved baseball. I still love baseball. Love baseball. I remember telling my parents that I wanted to join Little League. I was older, though, you know, for whatever reason, you know, we hadn't settled and, you know, we never found a league. I was older. So there's kids that have been playing baseball from little, you know, and their parents put them in clinics and, you know, they do all that crazy stuff. I just loved baseball. I wanted to play baseball. But like I said, I'm 34 and still 5'4". I was probably, you know, I was little then, I'm little now. And so I remember telling them I wanted to join baseball. And I was so excited and, you know, I had my glove. I was ready to go. And I show up to my first game, and I see all these kids. They're huge. They're huge. They've been playing for years, and here I come, you know, kind of cold turkey into it. And I remember being there, and I'd sit on the bench. Obviously, I wasn't a starter, okay, obviously. But I remember sitting on the bench, and I'd watch all these kids who were bigger than me, stronger than me. Parents bought them all the nice bats and took them to all the clinics and travel ball, all that good stuff. All I knew is that I loved baseball. But I saw how unqualified I was to be on that field. And I remember sitting on that bench thinking to myself, I'm okay right here. I love baseball. I'm just glad that I'm here. I love the game. I feel like I'm part of the team still. You know, I come to practice, and you know, once in a while, towards the end of the game, the coach will put me in. I'm okay with that. And I accepted it. I said, this is where I belong. And I lived with that insecurity for many years. And it sounds silly because it's just baseball. But I feel like a lot of us do that spiritually. Hear me this morning. I feel like a lot of us do that spiritually. I'm talking to you two pastors and leaders. I'm talking to everybody. But you know God, you love him, and you're grateful to be a part of the team, and you're here. But you sit on the bench, and you say to yourself, oh, they're better than me. Oh, he can preach. She can sing. I'm just going to accept that this is where I'm supposed to be. I'm not qualified enough to do what they do. I didn't spend the same amount of time that they did to do what they did. And I can't tell you how many opportunities I probably missed out on doing something that I love in baseball because I felt like I was unqualified. And I just felt God on this as I was studying this. And he said, there's people that are sitting out there that are feeling that today. And they look at the pastors and look at the leaders and they look at all this awesome stuff that happens on stage. But they're on the bench because they're doubting and they feel like they're not qualified. What would I have done? How much did I long as a kid for one of the coaches to look at me and say, son, maybe you aren't in travel ball like all these kids. Son, maybe you aren't as big as them, but I know that you have the heart to be here. So let me help you. I would love for that to happen. But that never happened. But can I tell you something? Spiritually, there is somebody who's watching you sit on that bench. And he holds out his hand. And on his hand, there's a scar. Come on, you got to picture this. You're sitting on that bench, doubting, not believing, saying every reason why you can't do what you shouldn't be doing. And Jesus comes and he holds his hand, and there's a giant hole in it. He says, this is what makes you worthy. He looks at his hand. He points to it. He says, it's my blood that qualifies you. Listen, you might even be on that bench, and it's your own fault you're on that bench. You sat yourself down. Come on, there's some leaders in here. You've served God a long time, and you sat yourself down. And you're saying, I'm okay here. This is where it ends. I'm accepting the fact that I'm on this bench. Listen, I don't know about you, but I make mistakes. I fall. But every time I fall and I stumble, every time I make a mistake, every time I'm hit with insecurities that would make me doubt my qualifications, I can't help but look up and see the shadow of the cross and think to myself, God, you died for me while I was here at my lowest. God, you died for me because you knew that I would fail and be in this very place. And in this darkest time is when you said, this is why I died for you. This is why I sent my son for you, so that I could pick you up, show you the holes in my hands, and tell you, you are enough. If David could do all this crazy stuff, this wild, if he could do all that wild stuff and still be known as a man after God's own heart, so can you. And some of you have been waiting for somebody to come tell you, hey, you are enough, you are enough. Listen, nobody ever came to me, but Jesus did. Jesus came to me. And every time I feel like doubting the qualification over my life, I look to the cross, and that's enough. If you base your life on what you think you're good enough to do, you'll never do anything. And I feel the Heavenly Father in this place this morning. He just wants to love on you. He wants to remind you that no matter what bad decisions you've made, no matter what things you've gotten wrong, if I can get the worship team up, please, no matter what you've gotten wrong, he got it right. Jesus did. You know, he doesn't make mistakes. You kidding me? He doesn't make mistakes. He knew that you would be here today. He knew that you would be carrying what you're carrying. And he says, I chose you. I qualified you. I redeemed you. I love you. Church, it's time to get off the bench. It's time to get off the bench. It's time to leave that place of insecurity. It's time to leave that place where you're just poor me, where you're just doubting everything that you do. Listen, to doubt yourself is to doubt the very character and nature of God. To doubt yourself is to say that, God, what you did isn't enough. To sit on the bench and say, I can't do this because they're better than me, is to say that you don't believe that Jesus paid the price for you. He is enough. He qualified you, not you. He did. And just like David, I'm not going to let my story end with my shortcomings. Just like David, I'm not going to let my story end because somebody close to me said that I couldn't do it. My story is going to be written by the hand of the Father. Your story is going to be written by the hand of the Father. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to ask for us to stand this morning. Listen, I feel the Spirit of God in this place this morning. I feel Him healing, mending hearts. And there's those of you that are in here today, and maybe it's your first time here, and you didn't even know that there was a man named Jesus who went to the cross and died for you. I'm here to tell you there was. There's a man named Jesus. He died on the cross. He paid the price so that you can have a relationship with Him and boldly approach the throne of grace. And I want to introduce you to Him this morning. So even as we're all standing, if that's you this morning, you say, I don't even know who this guy Jesus is. Pastor Chris, you've been preaching about this man who reached out and pulled you from the bench. Pastor Chris, you've been talking about this man who qualified him, but I don't know him. But you know what? I want to know him. If that's you this morning, can you just lift your hand? I just want to see those hands in this place. Come on, I see those hands. Praise God. Praise God all over this place. This is your chance to meet him this morning. Don't be in a hurry. This is your chance to meet him back there this morning. And then there's those of you that are out there this morning and you've been struggling. You've been dealing with guilt, with shame. You've been dealing with the fact that someone close to you has told you that you're not good enough. Life has told you that you're not qualified. God wants to meet you here this morning and touch you with his scarred hand and redeem you, restore you, and heal you. So here's what we're going to do. I'm just going to invite you up here this morning. If that's you this morning, you want to meet him, come up here. We're going to pray together. If you're out there and you're saying, God, I just need your scarred hand to grab me, just make your way up here. Start walking up here. Come on, we have the worship team up here. We're going to spend some time in his presence this morning. No guilt, no shame. I need him as much as you need him. Make the choice today to come to the one who can restore. Make your decision today to have an encounter with the God who tells your story. Come on, just make it up. And some of you are out there and you're fighting this. You're fighting this and I don't know why. I'm telling you this morning, Jesus is calling out to you. Leader, pastor, I don't care how long you've been serving the Lord. We all need him. I needed to be reminded that I'm qualified. I needed to be reminded that there's a God who chose me at my lowest point. Come on, just continue to make your way up here. God is in this place and he wants to touch you. His Spirit is moving. Come on. And I want to pray first with those of you who don't know him. Those of you that maybe known him a while ago and you walked away. And you came in this morning and he said, God, I just need to hear from you. Well, he's speaking to you this morning. He chose you. He redeemed you. So for those that don't know him, I want to introduce you to him. So what we're going to do, we're going to pray first. And I want you to repeat after me. If you don't know Jesus, if you want Jesus in your life as your Lord and Savior, I want you to say this prayer with me. Say, Dear Jesus, I know that I am a sinner. I know that you died on the cross for me. I believe that 3 days later you rose from the grave. Today, I invite you into my heart as my Savior, my Redeemer, and as the one who qualifies me. Jesus, let my life be one that I live for you. Transform me and renew me. In Jesus' name, amen. The worship team's gonna start singing right now, and I'm gonna ask the prayer team too to come on up here this morning. We're just gonna lay hands. We're gonna lay hands because I feel God all over this word this morning, wanting you to get off of the bench, wanting you to be broken of the guilt, broken of the shame, broken of feeling like you aren't enough. So we're gonna pray this morning. Come on, if you're out there, and maybe this wasn't for you, I don't know, it's for me. So I pray that even now you would begin to worship right where you're at. Come on, let's just sing to him this morning.
Death could not hold you.
God, this morning we look to you. God, this morning we look to you. We set our eyes on the one who took our place on the cross. We set our eyes on the one who qualified us. We look to you, Jesus, the one who paid the ultimate price. And we trust you. We cling to you. We clothe ourselves in you, my God. And we stand in agreement with what your word says. We have been justified. We have been qualified because of what you did. And so I pray for every person in this place this morning that you would encounter them in a new way. Reveal your heart to them, Father. Remind them that they are loved, they are called, and they are qualified. And I come against every lie of the devil that would try to exalt itself above your truth, my God. Establish your sons and daughters here this morning. We love you, Lord. We love you, Jesus. And we give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Come on. How many of you guys grateful for a loving Father? Thank you, Jesus. I know there's some people still praying here at the altars. You can keep praying. Come on, God's still moving in this place. But I want to remind you that you are called and qualified by God. And then secondly, I want to remind you that we have our potluck and Friends Day this Wednesday. Come on out. And I want to invite our first-time visitors. Before you leave, please meet us at that visitor sign. I love you guys. God bless you guys. May you go knowing that you are qualified. Amen. Come on. Praise God. We love y'all. We'll see you guys on Wednesday.